the current state of Rise of Kingdoms, there's been a bunch of really big changes in the game over the last couple of weeks that I haven't fully voiced my opinion on, so in today's video, we're gonna cover everything. What's going on, guys? Cheers! This is urine. Nah, I'm kidding, unless... Okay, so let's outline really quick what I want to talk about in this video. Okay, first we're going to talk about equipment refinement, we're going to talk about March of the Ages and KVK technology. I also want to talk about the possibility of the resource assistance cap returning in a future update, and then finally I want to talk a little bit later about VIP. Now, I've had a lot of you guys asking me my opinion on the equipment refinement system, and you know, it came into the game, everybody made a video about it, and let me just say, guys, I told you so, okay? I told you so. Roll the clip. This all, let's be real, let's be honest, I'm gonna bring it back to reality here for a second. This all seems too good to be true, right? Like, let's not get too excited. This is Lilith we're talking about, right? And every time they dangle something really exciting in front of us and being like, oh my god, they're listening to us, this is what we always wanted, it's always right before some bullshit happens, right after, okay? Mark my words, something is coming. I just feel it in my soul, bro. I feel it in my soul. When they announced the massive overhaul to the equipment system, I just knew that something was off. I just knew something was not going to be what the community wanted, because that is typical Lilith fashion. That is what they are known for lately, which is really, really frustrating. And it's honestly, it's a letdown, right? Because let me go on the record by saying that I love Rise of Kingdoms. I love this game. I mean, you guys, you know how many days I've been playing this game. I don't have to flex it in every video, right? And every time I go to talk about it, I click on my profile instead of VIP, 1027 days. Okay, I played this game a ton and I still love, I play it every day. I love this game, seriously, I genuinely do. You know, here we are, the refinement system is in the game. The only really good thing about this update is that, you know, A, if you continue to reforge equipment after like the third or fourth refinement or whatever the case is, the odds of you getting a special talent on that equipment are slightly higher than they were in the previous system. So that's good. Also, we are now producing, what, 50% more materials for the same amount of time, which is incredible. That's really, really nice. But, you know, with that being said, they've also really hurt the ability to get a lot of a specific piece of equipment for low spenders and for free-to-play players. So even though you're more likely to get a special talent if you refined a piece of equipment 2, 3, 4 times, the fact is you still are using blueprints to refine that piece. So while the probability of you getting a special talented piece over time is higher, you're actually not gaining more equipment as you're proceeding, right? So I can either refine this Eternal Knight for a full blueprint and half the material cost, or I can create a second Eternal Knight for a full blueprint and a full material cost. So while it does cost fewer materials, I'm still using a full blueprint to do so, which means that, you know, what I would do, especially with items like the Kurok's Humility, for example, is I would forge one, and then, you know, if it didn't special talent, I would dismantle it, or I would put it on a commander that, you know, could use that piece of equipment. So for example, we look at my Zenobia here, I've been forging and reforging the Kurok's Humility, and then as I would get a special talent, I would put it on a commander, and then I would forge a new one. And so over time, I was not only keeping my 3 Kurok's Humilities that I have here, but I was slowly making progress towards 3 talented Kurok's Humility. But in this new refinement system, you have to use your blueprint just to refine a single piece, so you're not actually getting a second piece. But when we're talking about legendary blueprints, they're really hard to come by even still. Now, you know, I waited a couple of days to talk about this in a video, and you know, it's just because I wanted to make sure that all the math was correct, and I didn't do any math, right? Shout out to Wit Gaming and all those guys who did the math to really figure out, like, is this system better or worse than the previous system? And ultimately, I do think that it, unfortunately, it's better in some ways, but worse in a much bigger way, right? So unless Lilith is planning on implementing more ways for you to get these legendary blueprints, then it's really not a great improvement. It's not a huge improvement, right? In fact, I think it's actually, it hurts the game more than it helps the game, right? Now, if we go into the tavern, the equipment chest does in fact have full blueprints for legendaries, which is nice until you look at the probability. You have not even 0.5% chance. The probability of getting this legendary blueprint is so low. Like, you need so many of these keys that unless, again, there's ways for them to pump tons of more equipment keys, into the game, it doesn't really make a difference, right? So overall, like I said, I feel like I just knew in my gut, I predicted this, I knew this would happen. They dropped the ball with the refinement system, okay? And honestly, it's easy for them to fix. All they have to do is either A, go back and re-implement the original chance or probabilities of getting the special talent on reforging, or what they can do is remove the blueprint requirement from a reforge. I'm sorry, not a reforge, a refinement. And that's the thing that bothers me the most, is why would you need a blueprint? Like, even just from like a from a logical perspective, right? Like, let's say in real life you go to a blacksmith and you want them to improve or refine a helmet that you already own. They don't need the schematics for that helmet. They just need to maybe add more materials to it, or, you know, reinforce it with some additional metal or leather or something like that. So I can understand refinement using materials, but I can't understand it from a logical perspective, using a full blueprint when you're not forging a full piece of equipment. So again, I'm not thrilled with this system, right? I do have a couple of pieces of legendary equipment that I would love special talented, but I would love even more to have multiple commanders with legendary equipment, right? So I'm put in a position where it's like, I don't really even want to take advantage of this new system. And again, this is something that I saw coming from a mile away. All right, let's talk about March of the Ages, okay? Because this is the brand new KVK Season of Conquest format. And honestly, it looks like they updated this a couple of, maybe like a week ago or something. This looks badass. Let's be real here. This looks super badass with the pagodas and stuff. I love it, right? The problem with March of the Ages, and I've been in this KVK for a few weeks now, it's not what people really wanted. And I know that, like, from a developer perspective, right, you always have to assume that the players don't really know what they want. And I know that that sounds bad, but even if you look at, you know, interviews from, you know, famous business people like Steve Jobs, for example, when they released the iPhone, there was nobody really asking for an iPhone, at least not what they produced, right? But, you know, when you're an innovator, or you're really trying to be on the cutting edge of implementing new things for your industry, whether it's your game or smartphones or pillow technology, whatever it is, you know, you have to assume that if you're making something that nobody's ever seen before, they're not going to know that that's what they want until you give it to them. Okay, so hopefully you guys understand that little tangent I went on there. But I see what they were doing with March of the Ages, right? They wanted to make a big grand KVK and slow down and make each fight even more meaningful, right? And to an extent, I think they've sort of done that. However, the problem with this is that people don't want slower gameplay, right? One thing that I've noticed with March of the Ages is I spend a ton of time just waiting for things to happen, right? You have to not only build your foundation stone, but then you have to wait to teleport. I mean, they really meant it when they said March of the Ages, right? Like, seriously, if I want to have my city in a strategic fighting position and also do ancient ruins every 39 hours, well, good luck. I have to walk 32 minutes. Have fun, Minamoto, walking for 32 minutes just to do ruins for an hour and then walk 32 minutes back. Like, it's insane how big, not only big the map is, but because of how restricted you are with troop movement, it's just, it takes so long to march places. It's like you're really hauling ass across this map, and it's like, it's not fun, right? Because this is a mobile game, and, you know, the beauty about Rise of Kingdoms is that even if you're at work or you're, you know, on the school bus or whatever, you have your phone with you and you can play it for a few minutes every single day. But, you know, if I'm on a 15 minute break at work, well, great news, it takes 20 minutes just for me to walk to a particular area where there's a fight going on, right? And, you know, God forbid, if I don't have a forward camp there, well, I'm already dealing 100% less damage than the enemy. So now I got to build a forward camp on my break. And then great news, that's going to take a few hours. And then I got to upgrade it if I want to send more than one army to a fight, which typically you do, right? And that's the problem. So, you know, look at this here, where we've kind of locked the enemy behind these passes. You know, if they start to push for whatever reason, I have forward camps here, so that way I can still fight them, and that's fine. But let's say they're gonna start fighting at this pass. If I want to reinforce this forward camp but keep my city where it is, I am, you know, in a position where let's see how long it's gonna take for me to send an army. Like, an hour. It's an hour of march time just to go here, right? Which is faster than teleporting. So that's the problem. It's like, it takes so long for you to fight on multiple fronts. And I get that, you know, that's the case for the enemy as well, right? It's not like they're moving faster than you. So for them to go over there would take them an hour too, right? So I understand that it's supposed to balance out in that way. But from a fundamental perspective and from a gameplay perspective, people don't like to wait around for an hour just for a few minutes of fighting, right? And again, you know, it's supposed to put strategy and emphasis on the few fights that do happen in KVK and make them more meaningful. So I understand that. But again, it's just, it's not really that fun. And this is a game, right? This is a video game. This is supposed to be fun, right? So I don't care what the data suggests players would want, or what the data suggests would increase daily engagement, or what the data suggests players will spend more money on. I don't care about any of that, because if the game's not fun, people aren't going to play it. So I think March of the Ages, you know, it's unique. And honestly, we've had some fun fights, and I got to be honest with you. Okay. We've had some fun fights. It's been great. But I think they sort of missed the mark on the fun perspective. And I think that the odds of people picking this specific KVK game mode moving forward is pretty low. I think players are going to prefer previous or other seasons of Conquest KVK types. That's just my perspective and opinion coming from somebody who's played it for a couple of weeks. Now, I do think there's still an opportunity for them to make some meaningful changes to this game mode, and that's that. Now, one other thing that I'll mention, and this was brought to my attention by the leaders of my alliance, is that this map is huge, and they didn't really do anything to adjust the cost of flag building, right? So the map is massive. And the density of crystals on the map seems to be roughly the same, but the cost increases every time you build a certain number of flags. And so if you're, you know, like us, a small kingdom with like one mega alliance that's trying to cover a ton of ground, well, good luck, because, you know, it costs us like 50,000 crystals or something for a new flag, which is crazy, right? It gets so expensive so fast. And so you really need to have multiple alliances building flags. But again, for smaller kingdoms with fewer mega players, then, you know, you're all in one alliance, because then you're all sharing purchase value and stuff like that. But, you know, for this KVK, you really need multiple alliances to be spread out. And so that's kind of the downside there. So I think there's an opportunity for them to adjust alliance flag cost just for that reason alone. I really think that Lilith needs to again reconsider the KVK tech. And, you know, this is my second KVK with KVK technology, and it's just not a feature that I find rewarding or satisfying to progress, right? Like, I'm making progress here only because in the back of my head, I know that when this KVK is over, all this progress is reset. And that just doesn't feel good as a player, right? Same thing with March of the Ages. You know, just because the data suggests that this is going to increase engagement or spend or anything like that, doesn't make it fun. And I feel like I'm wasting my time when I'm improving my KVK tech, because I know that this is not forever, and I'm gonna have to do this again in, you know, a month or two when we enter another KVK, right? So it just, as a player, I hate the feeling of making temporary progress or borrowed power, right? I'm only getting this power for a certain amount of time, and then if I want to get it again, I have to spend again and I have to invest again. And it's just, again, this KVK tech, I'm not a fan, and this is why people keep going back to KVK2. Lilith, you really got to address that. Like, you already have made a better KVK than the last four KVKs now at this point, right? We have three Season of Conquest KVKs, we have Light and Darkness. All four of those KVK game modes are less favored and less fun than KVK2. So it's time to reevaluate, look back at KVK2, find what works with KVK2, find out why people like that, and then implement that into a new KVK format, or make it easier for people to migrate back. And I know they're not going to do that because that hurts the new player experience, but something has to give. And KVK tech is just it's a parasite. Like, it is parasitic design from a gameplay perspective, because it's something you're forced to do that you don't want to do. And that's just not good gameplay design, fundamentally. And I think players have been very vocal about that, and moving forward, they continue to implement it because it makes them money. And, you know, it's just, there's an opportunity there to remove it and just make a KVK format that people actually like, so people don't quit your game. Really quick, I want to touch on VIP points. We talked about this in the player suggestions video, but I just want to emphasize it again here. The amount of VIP points that you need to progress in the VIP system is crazy, and capping it at 200 per day is just not the right it's just not the right number anymore, right? Like, we've had what, they've added 5 VIP levels since the game came out, or 4 VIP levels since the game came out. So I don't see how they haven't improved that specific number. It's just insane to me. I think what they could do is, or one thing that would be okay would be to do a VIP level squish where the VIP 18 costs the same as it used to cost to get to VIP 16 back in the day. Because even back when the game first came out, 200 VIP points really wasn't that much, right? So essentially what that would do is it would just make it easier to get new VIP levels along the way to that ultimate goal, which is still relatively unattainable, but at least the goals in the meantime are a little bit more attainable for people who are free to play, low spender, whatever the case might be. But ultimately, I do think that there is a huge opportunity for them to increase this VIP points. 200 is a joke. 400 is also a joke. Like, it needs a massive bump. And I'm curious to see, you know, will Lilith ever address this? Because this is a big problem, especially when, you know, you have VIP 18 buffs. 15% troop capacity guarantees that the VIP 18 players will be the best in every single type of canyon that comes into this game, which, again, you know, it has always sort of been the case, but with commanders like a 5511 Constantine, for example, even a low spender or free-to-play player can have decent commanders in Canyon, but now it doesn't really matter because there's so many more troops available to these high VIP levels. So this is just another thing that has been bothering the community, I think, that I figured I would talk about here. The current state of Rise of Kingdoms, we need more VIP points, Lilith. We really do. Put them in more places, make the daily points more abundant. Something needs to be done because a lot of players are really frustrated with the actual impossibility of reaching some of the important milestones unless you spend thousands. So that's really frustrating. All right, now the last thing I want to talk about is the possibility that Lilith eventually reintroduces a resource assistance cap. Now, it's clear that their intention with that update was to combat bots and resource sellers, which is a problem in the game. Like, that's legitimately a problem. I think anybody can agree with that. And the ability for players to get infinite free resources by having bot accounts is bad for the longevity of the game. So something has to be done, right? Now, the reason that I say they may reintroduce some sort of alliance or resource assistance cap is because of the message that I received in the VIP support. And I'm just going to read it here. I'm not going to list names, but this is, I can't even reveal the number to prove that this is real. But anyway, I reached out to them a few weeks ago when they first started talking about the resource assistance cap. And I basically, they said, they confirmed that the 10 million per day leak was fake, which was nice. And then I followed up with that by saying, will there be a future update that will use a different strategy for dealing with resource sellers and resource bots? Or will the team discuss possibly implementing a cap, but with higher limits than 200 million? They responded by saying, sorry for the wait. We have collected the player suggestions, and after careful consideration, we decided not to update the resource assistance and plunder caps for the time being. And the update of adjusting the resource point caps and collection speed will proceed as usual. So the fact that they used for the time being in that message is, you know, am I looking too deep into it? Or, you know, it's possible that they're just covering their ground in case they do eventually add a cap, right? But I think it's totally possible. I think Lilith wants to implement a cap for financial reasons, but because of massive player backlash, they pulled back on that. Now, I think in the future, they may implement a cap that is higher than 200 million. I would hope to see at least 500 million, if not more. But again, it's just, there's better ways for them to address this problem. And I've talked about this in previous videos. I think that it's something that the player base should be aware of. Okay, there is the possibility that they implement this cap again. And I don't know, I just hope that they're paying attention and listening to the community and trying to figure out a better way to combat these resellers and bots than with the strategy they've sort of gone with already. But the fact that they said for the time being really does make me nervous. Anyway, guys, those are just a couple of the important things I wanted to touch on in today's video. If you found this video informative or useful or anything like that, make sure you drop a thumbs up on it. It really helps out the channel a ton, and it helps get this video out into the YouTube algorithm so the Rise of Kingdoms players might see it. Comment down below what your current worries are for Rise of Kingdoms, or do you think Rise of Kingdoms is headed in the right direction? Are you happy with the game right now? if you're a new player, I would love to hear from you what you think about the game so far, because obviously I'm an older player, so I've seen a ton of changes with the game. But if you're brand new and you're loving it, I would love to hear from you down below as well. If you're new around here, subscribe to the channel and click that bell to be notified the next time that I upload a Rise of Kingdoms video. As always, all my social media links are in the description below, so make sure you follow me over there on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, Discord, all that stuff. It's always down below. Future updates and leaks will come to my Discord first before they're on a video, so make sure you go ahead and join that as well. There's also a link down there to download Rise of Kingdoms for your PC. It's a program called BlueStacks. I've been using BlueStacks for years, even in the Clash of Clans, Clash Royale days. I love BlueStacks. I think you're gonna love it too, so clicking the link does support the channel, and if you don't like it, you can always uninstall it later. And with that being said, guys, thank you so much for watching. This has been Omniarch. I will talk to you guys again soon. Peace.